Good morning, everyone, and a warm welcome. I didn't know how many folks would be here this morning. As you can imagine, through the week, I have been hearing tales of woe from many ministers of what has to be cancelled, rescheduled, reshaped and reworked, and many are assuming it would be them in the church mice that turned up on a Sunday. So, thank you for coming. Please be minded that at no point are you expected to sit or be in a position which is uncomfortable. If you at any point feel actually you're not so comfortable, you're at liberty to leave or change your seat and maintain your own safety during the service. Though, of course, the door remains ajar and we have a breeze coming through, so that should help all of us if we're keeping our distance at this time. There'll be a little bit more said about services to come in the intimation spot during the run of this morning's service. So would you like to sing a carol? We're going to sing a new one first, and it's one you've sung before, All Around the World. Still singing in Golden Hill, Chloe? All Around the World, It's Christmas. Well, if I see you singing, I know the answer is yes. So we'll find out. So let's sing All Around the World. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that was that a census should be taken in the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. Amen. Let's pray together. Great and glorious God, in the middle of what seems like trouble for us all and will be trouble for so many, still we can gather for worship in a familiar place with now familiar routines to keep us safe. We sing your praise. We tell the well-known story. And we leave room to celebrate all that it means to us, from childhood to adult life, from doubt to strong belief, from then till now. We tell of our God arriving in the world, flesh and blood like us, a mark of love, and a label that describes how desperate our Father is to win the people of this world for himself. Not just the humanity given room to grow and live and breathe and work in this world, but that great God's love that wants each to be a son or a daughter, one of his own family. And so we praise you, Lord Jesus, that you have become the one through whom we too are the babes in your arms, the child growing in wisdom, the servant capable of acts of virtue, love, and miracle, because your Spirit comes upon us all, not just at the moment we worship you here, but through the whole week when we make ourselves yours and make effort to live for you, telling the message of your Son to all who see us, hear us, work beside us and watch us. Bless us now, that we might be certain you are with us all. Amen. I'm going to read then from Luke chapter 14. It's about a party being prepared. When one of those at the table with Jesus heard what was happening, he said to Jesus, "Blessed is the one who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God." So Jesus replied, "A certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests. At the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to those who had been invited, 'Come, for everything is ready.' But they all alike began to make excuses. One said, 'I've just bought a field. I must go and see it. Please, excuse me.' Another said, 'I've just bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I'm on my way to try them out. Please, excuse me.' Still another said, 'I just got married, so I can't come.' The servant came back and reported this to his master. Then the owner of the house became angry and ordered his servant, 'Go out quickly into the streets and alleys of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind. Sir, the servant said, what you ordered has now been done, but still there is room. Then the master told his servant, go out to the roads and country lanes and compel them to come in, so that my house will be full. I tell you, not one of those who were invited will get a taste of my banquet. Amen.
It's nice to be back amongst you all today, particularly this important day. I missed a couple of weeks, unfortunately. Both the children had COVID, so were in isolation, and it was probably a reasonable thing not to risk spreading it amongst you. But it's nice to be back, and it's nice to see so many of you here. But while I was off, I had the opportunity to do a wee bit of extra revision. So I had a couple of essays that were due in, and so I was able to get ready. I've got them in early, which is probably about the second time in my life I've done anything that was early. But this morning is all about ready, getting ready. Joseph has to take his wife down to Bethlehem, in fact, up to Bethlehem. Joseph had to get everything ready. His wife was pregnant. Wasn't up to her to organise the travel arrangements or where they were staying. But she had a lot on her mind dealing with her pregnancy. So poor Joseph has to arrange the donkey. Joseph has to arrange packed lunches, the meals, the catering that they're going to need as they travel for about 80 miles from Nazareth to Bethlehem. And when they get there, he's clearly failed in his preparation, as there is no room at the inn. All of this happens in the background to our first reading this morning. Nobody mentions all the graft that Joseph has done, even to the point of finding a midwife, probably, in the middle of a busy town. Verse 4, Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, and that's roughly all we hear about it. But behind that is the preparation, getting organised, being ready. And in our second reading, you might think this is all a wee bit weird. Somebody's organised a party, and then at the last minute everybody's going, oh no, I can't come. Why didn't they just decline the invitation in the first place? The tradition back then was to tell people, I'm having a party. But you were never actually told when it was. You just waited until someone came along and said, it's on now. Now, I don't know about you, but our family certainly couldn't plan anything like that. We tried doing something only to discover that the girls had organised things that they hadn't put in the family calendar. But because it was then, the usual rule that applies to me, that if it's not in the calendar, it's not happening, that didn't apply. So things had to change. But this chap has organised a party. He's expecting everyone to turn up to his banquet. His calf is appropriately fatted. Everything's all sorted. Now he has to go out and send his servants to tell everyone to come. I'm busy. I can't manage. I've got a new field I need to see to. I've got new oxen I need to go and test run. I'm just married. I can't come. So what does he do? He's got a fully set table. Everything's all set. Everything's all organised. But there's no one there to share. So he sends out his servant, go and find people who would wish to come, who are happy to come, who want to share in what I've prepared. So the servant heads out and brings in the poor, the lame, the blind, the crippled to share at the table. But still, there's space. Go out and compel people to come in. Urge them to come in. Beg them to come in. Tell them my door is open and they're all welcome to share in what is on the table. And so folk are invited. Random people that the servant comes across. Come in, come in. It's nice to see you. And you'll enjoy what's here. Meanwhile, the organiser also said, see all the folk that were invited? They're not getting in. They had their chance. They'll have had their tea. Despite his preparations, despite the best intentions and the open invitation, people found an excuse not to come. They didn't have to worry about checking their ladder of flow before they turned up. They simply just went, oh no, can't manage. And we can't even today use our ladder of flow as an excuse not to turn up at anything. Oh, mine was positive this morning. Because you're going to be stuck for 10 days. So it's not an easy one to use as a throwaway line. But the invitation that Jesus talks about is the invitation to us all. The readiness that Joseph has had to do in preparation for the arrival of the child, that is what we are being asked to do. To make ourselves ready, to prepare ourselves for what is to come. And to accept the invitation that we are offered to come and share in the joy that is the relationship with Christ, the banquet that he will come to lay as he grows from baby to adult. So as we go home to look at our list, maybe even check it twice to see who's been naughty and who's been nice, as we prepare and get ready for what is to come for us, so we also should take time to prepare ourselves for what Jesus is offering. He is coming like a little child, and he will grow into an adult. He will give us an invitation to come to his banqueting table. Where we can freely get the grace that he is giving us. So let us go. Let us take the invitation and let us return to the table to receive all that Christ is giving us, both as a little child and as the man that he will come to be. Amen.
Sorry, folks, for the microphone trouble. Though it did give me a chance to be ever more familiar with the dials and the flashing lights on the amp this morning as I tried to make it possible for the feedback to get clipped and kept back as much as possible there. So thank you very much. We're going to just have our offering dedication. Many of you, of course, bring your offering in and leave it on the plate as you come in, and others from home are making sure that their offerings arrive one way or another with the treasurer or with the church, for which I'm very grateful. And if you need assistance in making sure your offerings do come into the church, just let any one of the elders know or send a message to me, and we'll certainly give you whatever help you are needing. Let's pray together. Almighty God, we give you thanks that you bless us day after day, and what a joy it is to be able to be involved in the celebration of your Son's birth, a momentous moment for the whole world, as well as those with faith recognizing at this moment everything changed. And might we know how to change every day, from being men and women capable of selfishness to being servants of the gospel, ready to accept that invitation to carry out the work of our Saviour and friend Jesus among the folks whom we meet and love. Amen. We're going to sing our next hymn together, Away in a Manger. Carefully. If the situation becomes so obviously grave that churches are closing, then I will put word out on Facebook and by email and ask you to tell each other to make sure that you've heard the message. So that we will be here to worship, next Sunday morning, Boxing Day. But between now and then, things have changed. There will be no service on Christmas Day morning. That's all right then, Esther. You don't have to worry. But church won't be on Christmas Day. So that's a change from our routines. It's just to make sure we're reducing the number of opportunities to affect the building or one another and just keep it to the Sunday. So you might be guessing then where we're going. We have Boxing Day worship at 11 a.m. Christmas Eve though is on, but it's outdoors. So, if you've ever been carol singing, you know what to do. You know what to do. Dress for the weather. I'm hoping, I've had a word, and I'm hoping that the cold snap continues right up. I can't guarantee snow. Nobody, even the weathermen, are not suggesting that. But dress for the weather. We will gather in the car park and round it, taking as much space as we want to and can between our households, so that we can still sing carols, we can still hear the Christmas story, we can still sense that we have celebrated an important day in our church calendar. And if others come off Faifley Road and want to join in, that's fine. Just remember, keep your space and all will be well. We'll be out in the fresh air with the breeze that's there. If it is very wet, well, I'll be here. Okay? Kenneth has already promised to be here. Ewan is turning up, but he'll be dry. He'll be inside playing the keyboard. But Ewan's going to help, and Kenneth's already planning to be with us. However many are with us, we'll do something. But if it is like this morning, it's a bit damp, it's a bit cold, do you know what? Turn up and sing as loud as me, and you'll manage. I will also be designing the service in ways that will keep your mind off your cold toes and the tips of your fingers, so that we can gallop through our celebration and go home knowing that we've done something, that we have made memories that will last and allow us to say, yes, it wasn't what it usually is, but we still got together, we still made something happen, and it still put a smile on our faces to be with one another. So that's how we are. And then there's the second and the ninth, which, although it will be week by week depending on any changes to practice required by the Scottish Government or by best practice advice from the Church of Scotland, I would still plan to have Sunday worship happening at 11 o'clock. Let's put that in our prayer and think of the many churches around the nation wondering what to do and how to cope. Let's pray. Almighty Father, up and down the country this last week has met many ministers and priests, many elders and deacons. Many have been wondering what to do. Well, our plan is currently made, and there will be worship. Lord, we pray that you would bless those congregations that have decided to continue. Might they be diligent and careful with all the risk mitigation that they have planned. And may every congregation that has changed how they are celebrating believe that you will still be present, that you will be with them in the changes that they have made. And may those who cancel be certain that they are making decisions which reduce the risks to their congregation in buildings that don't make it easy, in circumstances that just introduced too many risks. May each of us recognise and respect the calls that we make. And might there be a sense that just because doors might be closed or things are changed, that nonetheless men and women who believe as we do will be celebrating the love of a great God, one who knows that our circumstances, though they are difficult for us, are not the worst circumstances Christians are going through in this world. For there are many who fear violence, experience poverty and hunger, are fearful of raising their voices in worship. Might they have your blessing and your deep peace. For you are a God of this whole world round. Bless us all in our own circumstances, that we may know how to love, and to love, and to love in the name of the God who is love, acts in love, and invites us to live every day loving him, following him, and because of love, inviting our neighbours to hear the story that we tell every day. We ask your blessing the churches of Clydebank, that in all decisions they make, that there will still be witness to your Son and his gospel through all that happens every day. We bless the ministers connected to our congregations too. Jesus be with them and their office bearers, that all they do will witness to everything that our gospel tells us about a God who reached out every day and not just once in a year. Amen. Friends, I hope to see you at 7 p.m. if you're able to wrap up warmly and join us on Christmas Eve on Friday evening at 7. But we go from this place singing our final carol this morning. Good Christians all, rejoice. Ready to love and live in kindness, and may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and every day. Amen.
Those on duty would take their places, please.
Right, folks, we're going to be just leaving the building one row, but once a set of rows at a time. So if I can ask those who are at the back, and go on the left side first, if that's all right. You can take yourselves up and head yourselves out. That would be grand. Yeah.